Because my God isn't a God of voices. My God is a God that put it in your heart to come here to worship and exalt His name. He is our God. Why do we keep doubting the power of God? Lord, we are here to worship. Father, receive our worship.
Thank you.
say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done and continue doing in our life, Father. Thank you for this time of worship, Father, that we were able to not sing but worship your name, Father God. Oh, we exalt your name, Lord, and we want to thank you, Jesus. And we all say, amen. We need to worship team. Can we begin? Amen. And it's beautiful, like I said, to just, God, you have set us free. You have set us free. You're King of kings, above all kings. That is my God. Amen. That is who you are. So we're going to go back to offering. We do have offering and tithes as well. You guys can do it through Zelle. You can put 951-675-8661 for your offerings or your tithes. And then we also have those that are listening in the radio. You're more welcome to call us at 951-737-1717. So we're going to have a brother, and he's going to be praying for the offerings.
Good morning, everyone. We want to thank you, God, for this morning to really stay here in this day. Thank you, God, for all your blessing, God. We want to thank you, God, for every family here, for everyone. Is on this way. Thank you, God, for all your givings to us. Please keep here all our people. Give you a job for they can support their families. We want to thank you, God, in everything in His name. Amen.
Amen.
Christ. General revelation is all that we see right now. We see the wind out there. We see the birds. We see everything that God created for us. That is general revelation. I'm not going to get into that today, but it was part of my teaching. The Bible begins and ends in a beautiful garden with a life-giving tree located in each one. There's a good reason for this. God created the world for His glory, so that His creation will live unto Him, giving Him praise in all things. Genesis describes how everything God created was good, as we see in Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God created humans as His royal image bearers to rule over creation. So see, creation is not going to rule over us. We are going to rule over creation, which is what? The animals, etc. That is why God made us. We will rule over that. Tend His garden and care for His creatures. That was Adam's job in the beginning. Honoring their creator in all, Adam and Eve were righteous and upright with a full ability to obey God and keep all His commands after breathing life into the human, to the first human. So we see in Genesis 2:16 and 17, the Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat it, you shall surely die. So, if we hold on there for a second, essentially, what was going to be Adam's role? To not die, to continue. But God had a purpose for Adam, which is for what? To rule over everything. But they led him to sin. Adam and Eve were responsible to serve God and care for all creation under their domain. To prove their faithfulness to their Creator, God gave Adam a test. Adam must obey God's commandment not to eat the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in order to eat from the other mentioned tree in the garden, the tree which is mentioned in Genesis 2:9, and live forever in God's presence. So essentially, God created man first, right? Adam. So he had instructions, even then, a test to be obedient at all times. See, Adam wasn't just supposed to be obedient when he wanted to. He had a commandment to be obedient at all times. See, that is what God wants from us. See, He wants us to have that Adam. The original Adam was just to be obedient to His word. Like Pastor Tomorrow said, last night was an amazing, beautiful service. A lot of it had to do with obedience. When the pastor was giving words and administrating to everybody, one of the number one things that you will hear is, how obedient have you been to God? Now, we're not perfect. We sin, we fall, we get up, we ask God for strength. But the one thing is what? Obedience. How many of us are being obedient today? Truly obedient to His word. Not just to the things that we want to be obedient. See, there's a difference. See, there are things that we just want to be obedient to. Oh, you know what? I am going to be obedient to this because, you know what? It benefits me. So why are we obedient to the things that are going to hurt us or are going to put us to test? See, a lot of us don't want to be obedient to the things that we have to sacrifice. We don't. Because if I say, I only have $10 in my account, I look at my account, and you're telling me, God, that I have to be obedient and give it to somebody that needs it, but what about me? Who's going to give it to me? Well, see, that's what we forget. That God is in charge of that. God will repay you back 10 times more. That's what He did with Job. But He was obedient. How many of us are obedient? Adam and Eve were responsible to serve God. The covenant between God and Adam. The relationship that existed between God and Adam had a condition placed upon it, which was Adam's obedience, as well as a reward for obedience, which was life, and a consequence for his disobedience, which was what? Death. Because now he surely will die. God's will is coming. Just like each one of us, we're all going to die. One way or another. But see, it's not our time. See, we don't even have the right to take away life. Only God can take and give life. Right? Amen. So it's His will for us to go with Him. And Adam represented all humanity in this covenant. He really did. Because the beginning was with Adam. In the 17th century, theologian Hermann Wittes states, "If Adam therefore had preserved in obedience, the law would have brought him to the same inheritance." Which was what? Eternal life. See? That is what God originally wanted for Adam, eternal life. Until he ate from the fruit and he was disobedient, is what he said. Surely death will come to you. So that's what happened when he ate it. Which now in Christ, here we go, is allotted not to him which worketh, but with him that believeth. So now we have eternal life again. Amen? Which is by how? By believing and having faith in Christ, that we shall have eternal life with the Father in heaven. The conditional covenant relationship Adam with God is also known as the covenant of works. Jesus teaches us how the world's problems began. There was an enemy in God's garden, one who had rebelled against God and now sought to bring humanity under his domain. The serpent, a fallen angel, which we see called the devil, wanted the glory for himself. We see it in Isaiah 14, 12 and 15. Matthew 4, 8 to 10, and Luke 4 to 5, 8. He intends Adam and his wife Eve to disobey God. By eating the only forbidden fruit in the entire garden, falsely claiming that the fruit would make them like God, knowing good and evil. See, that's what the serpent will do. And he did, and we see it in Genesis 3, 4, and 5. So he whispered into Eve, and he told her, God doesn't want you to be like him. So even though this wasn't exactly that it was going to make him God, but see, the serpent lied right there. See, all they did was disobey God. They knew that they were naked or nude, right? But it didn't make them a God. See, that is what the serpent did. He said, this is why God doesn't want you to eat it, because it will become like him. The Almighty, the Omnipresent, the All-Powerful. So, what will the serpent lie to you? The things that you want to hear, but they don't come from God. See, that's how we gotta be careful and really be in the Word to understand what God wants for us. Because here comes the devil, he can come at you and lie to you, and you'll fall for it. I say, yes. For us that are, for you guys that are young and single, he's gonna say, yes, this is what, this is the girl that God wants for you. But yet, she wants you to fornicate with her. See, do you really think that's what God wants? No, but the devil will tell you that. The same thing with any aspect in your life, that is what the devil is going to do to you. The moment Adam and Eve ate from the fruit, their eyes were wide open. But not in the same way Satan led them to believe. They painfully saw the shame of their sin and rebellion against God and attempted in vain to hide from him. Adam and Eve tried to cover their nakedness with fig leaves, but their own efforts could not do nothing to remove their guilt and punishment. I was seeing Genesis 3 and 7. So let's stop there for a second. So what did Adam do? What did Adam do?
Try to cover his sin.
There you go. Well, see, what is it that we do? We think that we can hide from God. See, Adam and Eve, the moment they heard God, right? He came in and he just boom. They hid from God. How many of us try to do the same thing to God today? We think we can hide the sin. We think we can hide from God. We think that we are smarter than God. Yes or no? Little do we not know that God already knows the things way before you even thought you were going to say. See, the Word tells us that God knows the Word before you even say that about him. So we think we can outsmart God, but we can't, guys. See, Adam and Eve thought they could do the same thing. When God said, where are you? They were looking for them. And they said, well, we heard you. And we felt shame because we were naked. So God already knew what they had done already. See, God had a purpose and a plan. But the thing that I'm trying to teach us today is that we don't have to get to that. We don't have to lie. We don't have to hide from God like Adam and Eve did. We don't have to. And we don't need to. See, if we do something wrong, what does the word tell us? Come, repent. See, God doesn't say, you know what, you're going to sin 2-3 times today, I don't want you. You max out your sin. Just like when you go to the bank and you max out what you had in the bank, right? No, God doesn't do that. See, God is not that kind of bank. See, God won't do that to us. What he wants us to do is to come up here, get on our knees, and truly repent and not hide from him. Because the more you hide, what happens? See, one of the things that Pastor and I, we always talk about, and believe it or not, we talk to the kids about is, if you start one little lie, right? There you go, sister. I call it the snowball effect. Why do I call it the snowball effect? Because as far as you come down from the mountain, that little ball of snow that becomes the same size as this church as it rolls down the mountain. Well, that's how your lies are going to be. And your deceitfulness. What's going to happen? In order for you to cover that one lie now, you got to say another one to cover that one. Now, to cover the first two, now you got to say a third one. And to cover the first two, then you got to say, well, I said, you know where I'm going with this. To the point where your lies will catch up to you, and you're going to lie about it, and you're not even going to be able to keep with your lies. See, that's not what God wants for us. That's not what God wants from you. Amen? Because of Adam and Eve's disobedience, Eve will now bring forth children. Now we're bringing forth children in increased pain. So now we start to see their consequences of what Adam and Eve did. Now we start to see that the woman will bear a child with pain. I remember my wife, when she was giving birth to Jelana, she was in so much pain. She, I can't tell her, hey, take it to God when you go up there. It was not me who brought that out to her. Yes, it's partially my fault, right? You're pregnant. But essentially, it's not me who brought that pain. So if you got a problem with the pain, take it with God when you get up there. But see, that's what happens. So we start to see the disobedience, the result of being disobedient. Because of what Eve did, God said, now you will be in pain as you are fruitful. See, I don't know if God's plan was essentially for Eve not to have any pain. And I'm sorry, women, but now you do. But we carry on. And her husband would rule over her, as we see in Genesis 3:16. I read, I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing, and pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be contrary to your husband, but he shall rule over you. Meaning, maybe more likely, God already knew the woman was going to try to overrule. Now, I'm not saying women are stupid. No, that's not what I believe. I don't believe in that. Because there are men that use this scripture, and the men that are listening to me right now, that use this scripture to be abusive to their wives or to the woman. And say, well, you must listen and obey to me. But it's not that kind of obedience that God wants. God doesn't want men to mistreat the woman for that reason. He wants us to work together, but at the end of the day, when the man says no, it's no. And there's a reason why God does that. There's a reason why God gives that wisdom to the man, like King Solomon. He did it for a reason. Amen?
Amen.
God cursed the ground from which Adam must now toil to produce food. Genesis 3:17, 18. That is the man's consequence. Now, remember, God told Adam, all this is yours. Everything has been done for you. It will grow on its own. It's cultivated for you. So now, what is part of the man's punishment? From the ground that he must work now, he shall have food. Which means now, because of what happened, now the man must what? Soil his own ground. Move his own ground. Do his own, and that's how he's going to get food and drink. Then God replaced the man-made thing he lives, Adam and Eve wore. See, even God was still merciful and graceful back then to Adam and Eve. They had little figs. And then God gave them what? Garments of skin and clothing. So God still loves his children. As you can see. Yes, God will punish us. But God still loves you. Now, I'm not saying keep doing it over and over. Don't live in sin. But There's a difference between us sinning and a difference between us living in sin. So even though Adam and Eve did what they did, God said, you know what? I'm still going to clothe you. I still love you. I'm still going to wrap you with my love in my arms. Finally, God drove Adam and Eve out of the garden and placed an angel to guard the tree of life. Instead of communing daily with God, the sin of the first man and woman would make them unworthy to stand in their Creator's holy presence. So that is one of the most, I would say, consequences that we see in the scripture, that due to this, they couldn't be in the presence of God, His holiness. Now we ask ourselves, but was that punishment righteous? Was it too strong? Should have been more lenient. You might be wondering right now, did God overreact to Adam and Eve's sin? The punishment must be sin not to fit the offense. A cursed world that humanity estranged from God and pain. Suffering and death to boot. Offer eating some forbidden fruit. That's the same thing we say about our sins today. But God, it's okay. It was just a little sin. It's okay. We'll just lay in bed once. That's it. Just once. You don't have to punish me. I won't do it again. I just took that one drug just once, God. I just stole that one thing once. That's it. It's very little, Father. We continue to do that sin. See, and there's a difference between sin, which you did it once. You ask for forgiveness. You ask God to forgive you. You ask God to continue working with your heart. Continue to mold Him. Let Him be the potter, right? See, the spirit between the potter and what does He do? The potter sits, right? I don't know if you guys seen Ghost, the movie Ghost. I know it's an old movie, but it's the part where he sits down with the girl and then, you know, and they're apart. See, that's the part. So God, we're the clay. So allow God to continue. He's the part. Allow Him to continue to mold you to how He wants to mold you. But that's the thing, though. We don't allow it. We continue to sin and say, God, you know what? We come Sunday, it's okay. I can sin from Monday through Saturday. It's all good. It's all gravy. You know, Monday through Saturday, it's all good. Come Sunday, Lord, sorry. Whatever, amen. See, no, that's not how it works. See, that's not what God wants. God wants us to truly repent and not live in sin by not continuing to do it. Amen?
Amen.
Why was Adam and Eve disobedient such a terrible transgression against God? A man named Zacharias Hussinius addressed this very issue back in the 16th century. In this commentary on the Heidelberg Catechism, Eurydice lists six terrible offenses connected to Adam and Eve's acts of disobedience. And let's see. One, pride, ambition, and admiration of self. Man, not satisfied with his own dignity and the condition he was placed, desired to be equal with God. So, in other words, Adam and Eve wanted more. They weren't content of what they had. How many of us do not do that? Yeah. How many of us do not sin to get what we want? We see it all the time. We see it in TV. We see it in courtrooms where they lie. We see people murdering every day, lying every day, stealing every day, just to get to where they want. Somebody's in your doorstep. So, what does that tell us? Meaning, we will kill just to get to where we want. We're not content of where God has us. So right there, we're really just spitting in God's face and saying, hey, you're not that all-powerful because I'm not where I want to be. You're putting me somewhere where I don't want to be. You really think, God, that I want this job that only makes me $60, $70 an hour? Do you really want me to be here, God? See, and we start to continue with God like that. And we continue. And then that grows bigger inside of us. And that's when people start to walk away from God like this. Because they think that God hates them. Or God is not listening to them. But they don't understand that it's a process. See, Adam and Eve, when we talk about pride, ambition, admiration, is they weren't happy where they were. In other words, but are you willing, a family of four or five, to be in a one-bedroom apartment. Maybe that's where God wants you right now. Maybe that's where God is testing your faith right now. How faithful you are in your situation, in your relationship, in your work, in your finances. God doesn't want you to suffer, but he does test you. Amen?
Amen.
Second, unbelief. Adam believed the devil rather than God and ate the forbidden fruit, nor did he believe any punishment would overtake him. Why didn't Adam ever think to even question Eve? Where did you get this fruit? It's a little bit different. Why? Why do we believe the devil and God? You don't want to know why? Because what the devil has for you is the desires for your flesh. And that's what we want. We want to give our flesh satisfaction before anything else. We don't want to do what God wants us to do first. What do we want? To fulfill our flesh. That's what Adam did. Nor did he think there would be any kind of punishment. See, when you do things behind doors, and I tell you because I've done it before, I always told you, whenever I stand up, I would never lie to you guys. It's a promise to God and you guys. I would never lie. I did that. I said, nobody saw me do that. Nobody will ever know I did. Man, boy, was I wrong. God did. And I didn't get punished for it. And then I would ask myself, why is this going the way it's going? See, that was Adam's punishment. They had everything for themselves. Everything was being given to them. Lived eternally through the presence of God. And all that was taken away by one single bite of a fruit. So I'm asking you today, is it going to be worth that sin that you're about to commit? That you're thinking about the sin that you want to commit. Whether it's adultery, fornication, stealing, lying, is it going to be worth taking all those blessings away from you? Prolonging for you to get to where you have to get. See, when I was 18, I didn't question God. I just said, Lord, I am your servant, I will be obedient, and I will continue to do your work in here through these four walls. Now, I wanted to get out the next day, that same month, that same week, but I didn't get to. It wasn't what God wanted me to do. It was his timing. And this timing is perfect. Contempt and disobedience to God. This appears in the fact that he ate the fruit contrary to the command of God. The disobedience. Knowing that he was told. So God gives us the scriptures. See, the Bible is not just for you to have it. See, the Bible is not for you just to have it as an ornament at home. The Bible is not just for you to wrap it up in this beautiful cover and just bring it on Sundays like you really act like you really read it. Well, you just bring it so you can show that people that you're holy. A lot of us do that. I used to do that. So the scripture is a set of instructions for you to obey them, to abide by them. That's why it says, practice what you preach. So I cannot be up here saying, do not commit adultery when I'm cheating on the pastor. See, that would be completely the opposite of what the scripture says. In gratitude for benefits received, even though Adam was made in the image of God, which all of us are, and for the enjoyment of eternal life, his return for his benefit received was to obey the devil rather than God. Unnaturalness and the wants of love to posterity. Adam did not consider that the gifts God would have had bestowed upon him and his posterity would be lost not only to himself, but also to his descendants. In other words, he didn't think it was going to affect him in any way. And that's how sometimes we believe. See, we believe that if we just sin and ask for forgiveness, but not truly repent and stop doing it, that is where it's going to stop. But see, every criminal has his day. I don't know if you ever noticed that. So it doesn't matter how much he continues to do that crime and says, I got away with it. I got away with it. I got away with it. His day comes. Adam's day came. He didn't think anything of his punishment. By believing and obeying the devil rather than God, Adam wished to obtain equally with God. He set up the devil in the place of God, separating himself from God. So see, when you do that, you separate yourself from God. If you look at the definition of Satan, the devil, it's adversary. So adversary is that he is between you and God. So the devil is that sin. See, that sin that you keep planting in your life, and you keep doing it, that tree of sin keeps growing. So now instead of you being a good tree and harvesting good fruit, your tree is becoming an evil tree. And you're harvesting what? Evil fruit. But when you do that, that tree starts to separate you from God. Starts to separate you to what God's will is for you. So before you even know it, it's just like the people of Israel, when I preached it today. The scripture says that in reality, it would only take the people 11 days to get to the promised land. But it took them 40 years. How long is it going to take you to get your blessing from God? The theology concludes, the fall of man was not trifling nor singular offense, but it was a sin manifold of horrible in its nature on the account of which God justly rejected him and all his posterity. Because of Adam's disobedience and fall, all people bear Adam's guilt. That's what we say that when we're born, we're born sinners. But not until we get to the age when we can sin and God as the judges. Because Adam represented all humanity, furthermore, Adam's sin caused the corruption of his nature, including you and me. We now bear the same sinful nature. The Apostle Paul described the far-reaching consequence of Adam's rebellion. We see it in Romans 5:12. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because they all sinned. So now we come to the conclusion that the second Adam in the scripture is Jesus. Because now through Jesus, we have what? Eternal life.
Amen.
Now we have it. And you must believe it. And you must truly believe it. Because if you don't, you will not have that eternal life. So in conclusion, I would lie to myself and come to the altar and say, if I just ask for forgiveness, God will wash it. I can continue to be on Saturday with no problem. But that is not what God wants. That is not what God wants for you. That is not what God wants for me. That is not what God wants for your children. So let's be obedient to God today. Not just today. Let's do it Sunday through Sunday. We're not perfect. We will fall. I can tell you that much. We will fall. We will sin. But the more you get closer to God, the more that you're going to walk away from sin. It's funny because I say this. The old Adam, if I was walking in front of the back of somebody and they dropped $100, what would you do? You just pick it up and put it in your pocket. Just like that. And just walk away. But the new you will say, Mr. and Mrs., you dropped this. And that's what you have in Christ in you, because all you desire is what? Is to do good. You don't desire to do bad anymore. And that's what I'm trying to teach you today with this word, with this study. Because yes, we will sin. Let's not be like that. Let's learn from you. Let's learn from you. Any mistakes that you've done, if there's anybody in hate or anything, just get right with it. Stop doing those things. You already know they're bad. So what you're doing right now is not working for you. Do the opposite. And we pray today, come to the altar and truly give your heart to Christ. Truly ask for forgiveness. If it is that you're living in sin, just stop. He's going to take you straight to death, just like God forbid. Don't play with God. God is not somebody that you can just play with. Because God will kill. I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, no, God is just full of love and mercy and grace, God. But continue to play with God. And watch what happens. That's important. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
So I invite you to come up to the stage if you need prayer so you can pray for you. If you need prayer, come to his throne. That's what he wants. He's for you to come to his throne. If anyone needs prayer, we have our pastors, we have our elders, myself. So we can pray for you. Amen. Anyone needs prayer this morning so we can pray for you? So we do have welcome. Hi, nice to see you guys. We have Josie, how are you? It's her first time at the PAC Church. And we have my guys. Your name again? Your name again? Yeah. Ray. Ray, welcome to the PAC. I know you know your family come, but thank you guys for joining us today in the PAC Church. And you know, if you guys come to church, then you're more than welcome.
God rules in the wisdom.
sinners while you're here in the house of the Lord. Okay, guys, so thank you so much for joining us. Remember, also Wednesdays at 7 p.m., we do have what we have is the Bible studies. It's beautiful because Bible studies, not only do we learn and engage in the Word, but we come to worship. It's beautiful. So if you guys can, join us Wednesdays at 7 p.m., guys. We need to, you know, take our time for the Lord and do everything for the Lord. Amen. I want to thank you guys so much for joining us. We are also collecting a dollar offering. Let me tell you, if you guys even have a quarter, you guys have no idea what impact this makes for the children. We have toys, and especially I know there's a lot of youth here, but remember when you guys got your first toy? Remember when I go to the Walmart, at least it was Walmart, the sun store, with a little circle. And when she goes, she says, oh my gosh, she gets so excited with toys. And imagine these kids, how they feel. And, you know, let's be honest, we have everything. Our kids have everything. Our brothers and sisters have everything. And these kids, for a Hot Wheel toy, they get so excited. Like, wow, it's like if they got a promotion, like if someone gets a promotion, it's amazing to see this. So let's pray for that. We're going to close, pray to close the service. Father God, I want to thank you for this time, Lord. Thank you, Father, for this worship. Thank you, Father, for the word. And I want to thank you, Father God, for this dollar offering, because I know you will multiply it, Father. And we also come before you, want to end the service, and thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And we all say,
amen.
And we all say,
amen.
And before we leave, we also have so we have Sister Claudia. So listen, guys, go here. So when she comes down, we're gonna, okay? We're just gonna wait because she helps us to connect the radio. So as soon as you guys hear her come in here, we're gonna see the HAPPY.
What?
Do you guys know?